do need to join that up in some way, as I say, education, social care, schools, and the I mean, I think it's probably there's a kind of plan they can make, but we'll certainly need to have that.
The reason why Rachel and I are late is we've been to the new Parliament manifesto launch just now. And one of their key priorities is mental health for European and European and one of the things that they said was that when discussing mental health with their peers, one of the most important things that they found was that amongst themselves, amongst their peer network, they had someone to talk to who was able to just listen sympathetically and support them rather than creating further isolation. And so I really welcomed the greater emphasis on getting help to really young people amongst their own communities, amongst their families, as well as working with our partners. In terms of setting up the consultation,
part of the principle underpinning this approach, which I think is really important, is that we talk in the context of our service delivery in language which can sometimes be inexplicable to children. A tiered service delivery program makes no sense to a child, nor can they really make any sense of the distinctions between a tier 3 and a tier 2 service. And we don't necessarily understand why they're being referred to or being asked to speak to a particular professional or to peer. And so part of the reason, and I do think this is really important, that we have landed on this approach is because it uses language and terminology which makes sense to parents and to children. And so again, even if we decide this isn't fundamentally approach, we do need to address the significant issue of stigma related to mental health and ensuring that children are able to access support and help when they need it without needing to go through processes which they feel stigmatizing or unhelpful or actually not putting. So I think we're saying in terms of our own transformation, we recognize that and involving young people in how we best do that is really critical. So more than happy to work on that process.
Very briefly, I also really welcome the consideration of the iThrive framework. And I'm even a little bit more pragmatic to say, well, there is a framework that has attracted actually quite a lot of evidence. I would say that's our basis to start with. And yes, absolutely, we're going to have to consult and adapt locally. But I would say there's nothing wrong with using it as a basis to start with, because it's really well underpinned by lots of evidence.
If I can just add to that, but, I was involved in last week's design day around the Mental Health Care Plan, and spent a lot of time on the start round table, was about focused on young people's mental health. lot of congruence between the feedback that participants gave us on those tables and the principles, foundation principles of business and the modern framework. So I think that in our consultation, what we're likely to find is a more expressive and a section of agreement and a very positive response. And the other thing that I would say, I think, is that there's a movement towards this other way of working much more widely. And so in terms of that kind of that feeling you get when you're making a change and not everyone around you is on the same page, there's a convergence towards, and some people are ahead of us and some people will be behind us, but I think the general movement is in this direction of travel, and that feels an important thing to acknowledge, because if you don't find your immediate neighbours and necessarily speaking the same language at exactly the same time, I think we're going to feel.
One last response to that, which I think is important. The component of the model, which I think, mentioned this yesterday in the discussion with colleagues, which I think is fairly urgent, is the way in which we are managing the children at the top ends of the system where there's a high level of risk. But at the moment, there aren't any kind of clear frameworks about how to manage them, so we end up sometimes moving responsibility between agencies, whereas actually we need to have a more integrated approach to managing risk. And I think what the iThrive program brings is a kind of framework for experienced situations in working with young people across the across health, education and social care. Children with very complex needs, we actually don't have the frameworks in place to be able to have conversations. What I feel this approach provides is a kind of framework in which we can look at risk management that allows to more successfully hold the risk and work together to achieve the outcomes of children.
Just on the time scales, then, when are you likely to go out for consultation? When you might
I can't be absolutely certain about that, because we're hoping to start today. We certainly are thinking about going out to consultation through December, January, probably into February, so I'd say we'll probably come back in March around what the average time.
I think we're all happy to endorse and kind of in this approach. So thank you very much, and please pass on our thanks for the questions. Okay, agenda item 5 is the annual children's sport safeguarding.
I'm here representing the Making Youth Team, kind of chair of the Safeguarding Children Board, and the annual report does an annual tour of various boards in order to share good work for the board each year. So this report relates to the 2017-18 business year, for which I have to say I was not around, so I can't claim any credit for the good things that it reports on. There's an important programme of work for ourselves and our PMs and partners, of which the key partners are police and health, the voluntary sector and our schools, and we'll go much more widely than that. And the report that we have before you describes how we are basically addressing the kind of scrutiny function that the board has, and demonstrating that the board is open to learning, has senior representation, and the commitment from all the partner agencies really drives the priority of keeping children safe in Merton, focuses diligently on both kind of performance data and the more qualitative evaluation of how good we are or otherwise, and also delivers through an annual conference and a broader training programme good safeguarding training to all the participating partners. The board has a specific and very welcome endorsement in 2017, so during the course of this year, when it was evaluated by Oxford Standard and as part of Merton's overall judgment of being good with outstanding features. This board was one of the outstanding features, and there were no recommendations to the board for improvement. But nevertheless, it's not a complacent partnership and continues to develop its business plan and programme. The one thing I think I would draw to to attention as being a really important message for this board to take away. This is the priority of the Safe Coming Water House around the same family. This idea of using an adult to the child, that adult is responsible for, it's the child, the adult in that child's family, and connecting different bits of our system together. There's significant work being undertaken by the partners with that in mind, and more to come during the business year and the year that follows. The other thing that I draw your attention to is the fact that the Safeguarding Board, as currently constituted, will not continue beyond September next year. Because the new working together guidance requires a different kind of safeguarding partnership. So even though it's an outstanding board and the partnership works really well, we've got to make some changes because the legislature and the expectations have changed. And we're working together as a group of partners to make those changes now. We're currently work in progress, and we're taking that forward with the expectation we should be able to launch ahead of the deadline in April.
I'm just going to come in with more of a comment than a question. Likewise, I was not around in 2018, so my thanks to those who came before me. But what is really clear from this report is sort of the spirit of reflection, challenge, and improvement that I hope will, I'm sure, will continue into the partnership that comes after. And on that note, I think that if there is anything that you take away from this report, it's the progress plan in Appendix 1, which sets out our priorities, objectives, outcomes, who are doing them, and when they should be achieved by, which is a good way of monitoring the progress of the
I thought it was a really comprehensive report. It took a while to read, but it was really interesting. I have two questions. I think they're quite short, hopefully. The first one was just, I think, that we have, obviously, we support so many people at Men's Hill, and a number of those people are parents, so you're very anxious about accessing support and worry about the implications of that. And I was just, that's sort of alluded to on page 39 as well, and I just wondered what ways there might be or what support might be available, just so that we can sort of link people into support in a way that feels very safe to them.
Yeah, I think that's a really good question, and difficult to answer specifically because it will depend on those parents presenting need. So the intention behind the family approach is that wherever you turn to for your support as an adult, it also recognises you as a parent, but does so in a way that's not catastrophising, or stigmatising. So it's not saying, oh my goodness, you have this additional need around your mental health or around your disability, therefore you can't be competent as a parent. It's the reverse. It's saying, what can we do to support you, understanding that you have a dependence, and indeed you can have a dependence on every kind of children, maybe other dependents. So I haven't got a specific answer because there isn't a kind of a dedicated, if you're a parent with mental disability, if you're a parent with mental health difficulty, this is what you should turn to parenting advice. But what we're trying to do through the family programme is making sure that when you turn to children's services advice, we recognise your need as an adult, when you turn to adult services, we recognise your need as a parent.
Yeah, even quicker. So on page 70, it mentions a mental health protocol done with adults and children safeguarding, but I wasn't quite sure how to access that. It sounds like it might be something very helpful and useful. We couldn't find it on the adults page on the website. Thank you.
I'll check out where it is. Thank you.
It sounds like it should be helpful.
I'd like to start by just putting on record the CCG support for the report. Been actively involved in scrutinising the implications of, for example, clearly just to add to the further positive comments and just to know that we think it's a very effective working relationship.
Any other comments?
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Can we note our thanks to Keith and that's where it's been passed back on and to all the team who have been involved in this. And look forward to working in. Sure. Right, agenda item 6 is the suicide prevention framework.
Thank you. So as a health and wellbeing board, for a while now we have the aim to not only think about physical health and a healthy environment, but concentrate on mental health, and that's why today we are presenting two mental health papers, trying to explore really how the board can add value. And I would like you to endorse the suicide prevention framework and help really in your role and with your constituencies and organisations to champion the approach. The framework is not a single freestanding new thing. What we've really tried to do is to embed the awareness and implications of suicide into other services. And so the importance is also that in the financial situation we're in, there aren't extra quick pockets of money to implement this strategy. So we have been explicitly collaborative, frugal, and building on existing infrastructure. But we think we've actually pulled together, through the real dedication of the people who are listed in the appendix, some very tangible and practical means to reduce further the tragedy of suicide. The idea is that this is a five-year strategy, and every year we have a sort of rolling action plan that gives us enough flexibility to adapt as we go along. We also, I wanted to draw your attention a little bit, without taking too much time, on the scope, because as Paul already alluded to, there is a lot of emphasis now on emotional mental well-being to children and young people. A lot of work has particularly locally happened around self-harm. And in a way, fortunately, the number of suicides among children and young people is very low. Obviously, everyone is a tragedy. But the number of self-harming children and young people are very high. So the link between the two are so small that we've said work on self-harm is not covered in this strategy. So that's quite important, but the work in self-harm is happening as well. It's a life course approach, and we have followed evidence-based frameworks that have been suggested from elsewhere, with the emphasis to actually reduce the suicide, but also to support the movement. And just in terms of governance, as I said, we're proposing to use existing the CAMS partnership board that the four chairs and he has already mentioned, and then for adults, the mental health board. And we would like to set up a forum only once or twice a year with a wider group of stakeholders to actually hold us to account, challenge us, and also adapt and adopt the action plan. I think that's probably enough for me to set the scene and then over to you for questions.
I think it's a really good piece of work. This is such an important topic, right through from childhood to adulthood through university. I like the idea of a suicide prevention forum for stakeholders. Would it be all stakeholders? Where would you draw people from maybe from the public to actually look at the governance of this. Thank you.
So we are quite open because we are finding our way and experimenting. So any ideas are welcome. We are at the moment considering the size. Is it more almost like bringing a wide range of stakeholders together and then possibly only once a year, or is it a smaller group that has some experience, or we are not quite sure yet, but we are open to suggestions and ideas, and we would very much welcome representations from the constituencies of the HWBB.
Yeah, I do think it's a really important thing that we work on. I think the actions in there look very sensible. But my question was, in determining what the actions are, have we looked at the root cause of suicides in Merton? Are we absolutely clear that the actions that we're setting out are going to be the most effective? The one that I was particularly thinking of was the importance of interagency communication. I know there probably have been in some of the suicides opportunities perhaps to prevent or intervene earlier if the information sharing had been better in our system. So I wondered if we might want to pick that up and also just link in any case reviews or root cause analysis that's been done to the actions.
I think it's a really very helpful consideration. I will feed it back. We're going out to the clinical oversight group as well, because we want to very much make contact with clinical and practitioner colleagues, and communication has been raised from that end. So I think very good consideration committee. I just wanted to also draw it to your attention one other point, because we have the children's discussion just preceding. Thanks to Rachel's spotting, we've actually amended our age range for children from 0 to 19 to 0 to 25. And it is a general ambition that is also reflected in our little health and care plan that childhood doesn't stop abruptly with 19, and particularly in vulnerable children. So we've made it explicit.
Just a commitment, really. Thanks for the report, which I found interesting and shocking as well. And whilst we weren't here on that's the crucial to the read across to a number of the services in the responses for particularly the offices around the place and the relationship and those who are responsible for the most part as well. People commit to this, I don't know, not to this, but I think so, I'm sure from the services weren't there. So I'll take this back and make sure that it's discussed with my team and that's really helpful. So thank you. Thanks for that.
I was just hoping to clarify around self-harm, because I was clear from the report that young people's self-harm is out of scope, but is that also the case for adults? Because certainly in the work we have, there are a number of services who do self-harm, and sometimes it can be difficult really to again link them into appropriate support, sometimes because they refuse it as well. So there are just a number of complications, I think, around the link with self-harm, but also how to really get people into places that can support them when they have to do that for a range of reasons.
Well, I think we've wrestled quite a bit with the scope, and the traditional way is that you combine self-harm and suicide, because in the former days, where the numbers of self-harm, at least the numbers we were aware of, much, much smaller, it made more sense. So on the other side, we are using the traditional model, so any indication of self-harming is actually a high-risk factor for suicide. The link has been broken only recently in children and young people, and so we felt we just don't do enough justice to the epidemic problem of self-harming children and young people if it is dealt with in the suicide prevention. But it's not like that in the division now. We are obviously having one theme in this strategy, which is emotional and mental well-being, and that is underpinning all our mental health.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think we largely support this. I was also present for a conversation that your team had with the local medical committee where they fed back a number of comments which I know will be taken on board. Just on page 25 of the strategy, page 123 in the pack, it talks about primary care and healthcare professionals and their reduced stress. And I found them very useful figures under 512. They're what we've known anecdotally for some time, but I haven't seen those figures before. I was wondering whether as an early priority we could explore the implementation of the new primary mental health service in April 2019 as an opportunity to do some active communication with our healthcare workforce. They'll be coming out of what may be a very difficult winter, and with our social care workforce as well, in order to make sure that we've got people accessing primary mental health services, psychological therapies early enough, and that we're sort of catching people who may need some of that support within the health care work.
Absolutely taken. So I suppose I just want to make one overall comment on the report. So we've got lots of very good suicide prevention strategies across NHS, for example, our local mental health provider across the mental trust. I think the one thing I don't want to miss about this report, we're actually talking about this. So it's bigger than just the services. It's that borough awareness of what we actually do, whether we're down at Morden station getting on a tube, and it's that talking where we're worried about somebody's presenting anxious, it's training us what to do. So ordinary joke calls out there when it's down to our conversations. And I think that's critical, and it feels nice that we debate about that stigma on mental health, removing that stigma, and it's okay to have these conversations. We won't all know how to react, and that's absolutely fine as well. But I think it's really starting to open up the conversations. I mean, Dagmar is absolutely right. We don't have massive money. We don't have the answers to all of this. But what we can do is actually start raising that awareness across all of the departments, not just health, not just social care, but transport, local shops, all of that plays into it. I think it's a really important part of what we're doing this report.
I'd just like to build on that point, actually, in that one of the things I found most shocking about this is we know that traditionally men are more likely to commit suicide. What's the better word?
We'll think about that.
But looking at working with employers, especially in the three highest risk groups, like construction, agriculture, the frozen population, where unskilled or skilled trades male workers are working, and more work we can do to raise awareness in those sectors across Merton. I know that's particularly hard because we don't necessarily have much buy-in there. Not sure we have much agriculture anyway, but looking at making sure we raise awareness and really about that thinking.
So absolutely spot on, and again, we're not the only borough tackling the same issues, and so we are very much working on a sector level, which is really helpful for awareness raising, but also at the London level, and we're linking up with the Mayor's Thrive London programme, which is more generic, but one of his six priority is a zero suicide city, and a lot of awareness raising to talk about mental health. And we at CCGs and London Councils, not all but most, are investing in a programme which is called Good Thinking. It is a digital mental health programme that is accessible to all. If you would Google it now on your phone, it would come up. If you would Google, I can't sleep, or I'm low, or I'm depressed, or I'm anxious, it would also come. And it is an evidence-based programme. And what we're doing at London level is working with big employers, like construction, but also other big businesses, the Royal Mail, to say, use that with your workforce. And it's another opportunity, Chris, as well, for the services that are outsourced now, because it costs nothing, and it's very easy to use.
Folks, for one, asked me to just ask to what extent there's been engagement with service users directly, obviously, that's a very comprehensive task group. But they also mentioned that they've been working with Health Watch Merton to develop an adult mental health directory. I don't know a lot about it. They just wrote to me this afternoon about that and asked me to mention it.
So with regards to service users, that is obviously a very sensitive and tricky territory. Not calling and asking, working with bereaved people requires a particular sensitivity. So what we've found for the task and finish groups, we've worked very closely with Southwest London and St George's, who actually have user groups and bereavement support groups, and we've in a way piggybacked from their knowledge.
Sorry, by the way, apparently it's died by suicide.
Thanks, Liz.
One of the things that really struck me was the building on the concept that Kelly and James made, the difference between men and women, and the fact that with men it tends to be generally less affluent and lower skilled, whereas with women, James mentioned healthcare workers, but it also mentions primary school teachers. And I suppose one question for Rachel would be, what feedback do we get from schools around stress levels, but the teachers? And in regards to men, I mean, the statistic for our over 65s is shocking. But I wonder if these are people, we talk quite a lot about social isolation and people who are unknown to services, and these are people, presumably, who don't necessarily touch some of these services. That we're trying to train up. So if there's a fundamental difficulty there, isn't there? James.
Just on that point, I mean, I think there's a significant overlap between the cohort who may not previously be known for services, particularly in our group of men, particularly in areas of economic deprivation, and also the cohort that we look at support for social prescribing, because they're often this cohort who presents potentially with typical healthcare symptoms, and then when GPs they don't need causes of typical healthcare symptoms, they find a number of issues that may relate to mental health, may also relate to financial concerns as well, and more general sort of emotional and psychosocial presentations, and that's where the social prescribing will come with some support. So I think that one of the areas again that we might want to look at, and I think it will come up through a number of mental health care together priorities, is identifying where we are looking to support the same cohort of people, and then presenting a number of different priority areas that we hold together, and you know, seeing that it's the same cohort and saying how do we support their wellbeing more generally, and then how does that come through all of our strategies?
I don't know if there's more to be comments specifically on parents or teachers, or we haven't done a piece of work specifically around stress and pressure in our school workforce, but we know more broadly, across the teaching workforce as a whole, that it is a very stressful occupation, something might be surprisingly so. There's a considerable amount of pressure in the classroom, there's pressure involved in working with families that may be in need, and that presents in school, and teachers raise workload concerns and also behavioural management concerns as key causes. So it is something that we should certainly be careful. The other thing that's worth saying is, for anyone died by suicide, it's attractive for them and those close to them. When it happens in the school, and the community that is affected is enormous and devastating. So all of the children in the school do use a charity member of staff, or it's a teacher or a member of our teaching staff. And if it's a suicide by a young person in the school, the consequences for that healing system as well. So it's worth understanding that there's a broader community that
I think we all agree this is an incredibly important piece of work, so thank you for the coordinating and thank you to everyone who took part in the task group. And I think we've had a number of commitments from partners around the table regarding their own workforces and a piece of work on what we need to do for social workers and healthcare workers and maybe schools as well. Thank you, Dagmar, and perhaps we'll see it again in a month's time or so. Okay, I'm just going to tweak the agenda slightly because I think there's merit in taking the health and wellbeing board strategy before the health and care together paper. So I'm going to ask Chris to present the local plan paper, if that's okay.
Yeah, so a very short introduction from my colleagues and partners. That's I worked left in the consultation period for second stage for the local plan. I can just follow on from the conversation I was having earlier to reinforce the importance of this is the development plan document to define our planning policies for submission of the plan. We go through a lengthy public inquiry and enshrine in our planning policies, supplemented by such items as the Women and Master Plan, which is planning guidance, not planning policy. So this assisting setting the future policies for neighbourhoods as well as a variety of themes and set change planning use for a variety of sites that have been put forward. Health and all policies have been enshrined within this and Civic Health and Wellbeing chapter to draw the attention to the money to have a look at it and do comment in the future. We're working well with Lucy Lewis on your side of things. We're looking at particularly at population projections and demands for GPs and trying to get a better understanding of what the future intentions are about GPs and premises and whether they exist and whether we might need to be providing the GPs on the right time of this. That's it, Jeff. Okay, thanks for your question.
I'll see you on the report talks around sort of design and public around sustainable transport and obviously health infrastructure. One of the things we hear a lot of is the prevalence of things like vetting shops and fast food takeaways and proximity of these things to schools. What powers do we have to address that through the planning system, if any?
Fairly limited, to be fair. There are some, just looking at one of the policies this afternoon, actually around fast food takeaways, and putting some greater requirements on those who seek to apply for those establishments, so that we can, within the powers that we have, limit the prevalence of those, and ensure that if they do exist, they sign up to healthy eating commitments, and they've got some controls, and some ability to ensure that the best you possibly can do.
And air quality has obviously been a big issue in the past few weeks. What considerations do we have in regards to air quality for the new permits?
Well, huge consideration in terms of the way in which we will seek to do a more sustainable transport approach in particular. Set alongside the air quality action plan, which uses this as a means of seeking to change the way that we can develop, the way we're building infrastructure for cycling, the sustainability of individual homes and their type of heating systems and renewable energy that we expect to see in the development of this process. So it sits side by side with the air quality action plan and the air transport strategy and really pushing that agenda around air quality.
Perhaps we can circulate the link to the Health and Wellbeing Board and we have a look at the chapter on health and wellbeing. And thank you, Chris, for the update. Right, so now going back to item 7, which is the health and wellbeing strategy refresh.
So it fits quite nicely in a way. I think about it a bit like an onion. So Chris has talked to you briefly about the local plan. That is the built environment. And I'm now talking to you about the health and wellbeing board strategy. We as a board, as you will know, statutorily have a responsibility to provide a strategy, and we have the duty to be the system leaders for health and well-being for our population. And as I've presented to you and agreed with you previously, that the refresh of the new five-year strategy for next year onwards, the health and wellbeing board wants to play a particular focus on creating a healthy place, because the feedback we have from our communities as well as from our clinicians, I remind you on our diabetes truth program was that we have to obviously have a focus on the health and care services that we provide, and James will talk about the local plan. But because a lot of our health and well-being is really flavoured by the environments we live and work in, and so as a board, we have the leaders jointly to really focus on what does a health-promoting place look like, so that then we can work hand in hand. And diabetes was such a good example that, yes, of course, a person who's diagnosed with diabetes is absolutely dependent on good health and care services. But my God, you know, even the food environment is actually tricky to manage. And it was very helpful to live this through, and the inspiration in the way that Chris and all of us got to think, what can we do about the environment? And I think the push for active travel, for example, is a really concrete opportunity. The work that's happening on parking charges is a concrete example. The work we're doing around super zones around schools, so how can we create healthy environments around schools? These are concrete, real examples where in we're trying to create an environment where the healthy choice is the eating choice. So that's where we are focusing this refresh of the health and wellbeing board strategy. We're very keen that amongst all the glut of strategies, we're not all doubling up and writing everything laudable in every strategy, that we're really thinking which bit of the system can do what best. And so we're working very closely with the local health and care plan. We have the same themes for our health and wellbeing strategy, as you have agreed: start well, live well, age well. And we have the particular emphasis in a healthy place. And we're running the four workshops for all these themes. One we already had. Many thanks to a number of you who attended. And the idea is that you as members really own the strategy, and that together with our stakeholders, our connectors and our community, we decide where we can add most value. It doesn't mean that there are lots of good things that could be done, but as Chris always says, we can do everything, but we can't do anything. No, what do you think? We can do,
we can do anything. We can't do
everything. That's it. I like that, and I'm messing up. But it's stuck in my mind. And that is the struggle for the strategy as well. So what are the few areas, if we pull together, we have most effect? So I'm inviting you again. We have sent invitations for the upcoming workshops, one on HWBB, one on HWBB, and then the one on healthy places, which we want to use to draw together with all the previous ideas and say, how can we now support all those ideas? That's the plan. Launch is sometime next year, I think March will come.
Before I answer the questions, can I just ask Rachel or Kelly to say something about the start of the workshop? Key things coming out of it.
Well, the ones that you see described in the report, so we've identified some emerging priorities so that we can kind of close the discussion on those and firm up on them yet. So we had early years, infant family, child obesity, and once again, mental health or emotional well-being of children and people, and those are the things that we explored. One thing I would say about the start of our workshop was we started well by starting well. You know, we're kind of following the logic of the live course in the way that we're conducting these workshops. The participation was really good. The engagement was very strong. And the sense of wanting to link start well actually to the healthy place priorities came through as well. So people understanding Merton as a place that you wanted children to just have a great time growing up and really thrive across all of the domains of their well-being.
One thing I might say on that is that I look forward to, hopefully, attend most of the conferences so that we can make sure that any sort of learnings from children's schools and really hope that the same group who attended the start of will all be invited to do that in a healthy place. It might mean that we need a bigger room, because I think that it's so critical to think about our children and young people within the context of our built environment. That's why I think looking at the effects of the local plan on our young children is really important. Things like promoting health in terms of removing no boarding signs so children can play outside, or protecting and supporting our youth centres so they've got access to multi-use games spaces and things like that. Just really feds in the importance of our children's schools and families practitioners being involved in the in a healthy space conversation.
Work in progress, but next time it comes back, we'll certainly have one more for the so thank you, Doug, for all the work on that. So now going to the supplementary agenda to take item 12 on the supplementary agenda, which is the Merton Hub Getting Together.
Thank you, Chair. I'll introduce the item and I'll also ask if Hannah, as co-chair of the Merton Hub and Getting Together programme, will also add anything to what I say. So, at the last Health and Wellbeing Board, the Health and Wellbeing Board supported the high-level priorities that have been identified by the Merton Hub and Care Together programme, which are very much in line with the Health and Wellbeing strategy and also with the existing priorities identified by both health and care organisations in the borough. You will see within the presentation that we've now developed some further level of detail in terms of some funding of the page, and we're now developing a detailed case for change and also scoping in detail the programmes of work that fall under each of these areas. And the case for change will really say, in addition to what we are doing already as part of our strategy, the statutory bodies and as providers of services, how can we achieve more for local residents by working in a more joined way? This will be supported by the outputs of the event that we had last week, which was very well attended. We took the priority areas to the event, the local health and care plan event, and we used the presence of many stakeholders, clinicians, other workers from the services, and also members of the public, test the priority areas, and also to get them to identify what, from their perspective, would be priority areas for us to focus on, and that will also input to the programme. And this will come together in the form of our local health and care plan, which we will intend to bring back to the Health and Wellbeing Board for the next year. As well as developing a plan and a strategy, the programme is beginning to identify early areas where improved joint working can benefit local residents, and we have our first initiative, which is an integrated single point of access across community services and social care services post-acute discharge, which is now in the process of being implemented under the oversight of the board, and this will make a tangible difference to how we support residents living hospitals this winter. So it's a really positive opportunity to test some of the joint working arrangements with a relatively small piece of work with the customers and concrete inputs. Thank you.
So I think just to I think, yes, we're raising the green paper on social care, and we're making the 10-year energies plan. But actually, from our experience of last winter and the board has started to develop something running with our five partners, felt quite important that we started to do some things, that we were able to go out and describe to people. This is not just about the board and the partners, it's actually some stuff that can go to the bit that's residents now, because that's where it led us to think about the front door, this time not the back door of the hospital, because in the last year it was getting people out safely and getting home safely. So I think it's been a real opportunity to pilot it, and it is pilot, and we'll see how it goes, but we can kind of work back and shape that. But just it's been very welcomed on the community schools, in particular St George's. And I think it is ready to press go. I just really do want to kind of highlight here the work of CLCH and social care teams, because they're just moving up and down on their way through some of the challenges and not on with it, and ready for us to be able to do this winter. And so it's an exciting piece of work, and it should feed into social care planning.
So just a couple of things to mention. The first was on the necessity really because of the design of the day last week, children and people couldn't be involved. We did have a number of very young adults who had some kind of well-informed perspectives on what it's like to be an adolescent. They have blonde in adolescents themselves. So the public participation was great on the day, and they were very helpful. But we're doing some additional work outside of that design to ensure children and people's resources feel part of it. The other thing is to elaborate very slightly on the pathway to adulthood piece in the start world, because I'm conscious that that is probably the least well understood of those priorities. And what's crucial is that when it's talking about transition there, it's not talking about transition from children's services to adult services. This isn't a service perspective. It's about understanding what Dagmar alluded to earlier, which is that there isn't this sharp sort of point when the law tells you that you're an adult at 18. That's not necessarily how you can be feeling differently inside. And within this piece of work, we're looking at not only those areas where children's services have statutory duties to young adults long after they've left legal childhood, and that is for young adults with special educational needs and disabilities and care leavers, we have specific statutory duties, but we're looking at the well-being of everyone in that kind of late adolescence into early adulthood, because there isn't a kind of smooth dividing line between those both points. So if you unpack that part of the problem, that's what that would mean.
So a question from you then. At the collaborative leadership group of the six on the virus last month, we were all asked to talk through the emerging plans, and I think it came across that there was quite a lot of similarity, wasn't there? And clearly there's a number of things that are bespoke to each borough, but equally there are things that were common to all. And I just wonder at South West London level, is that a conversation being had as well to save us all sort of reinventing the wheel in our own boroughs?
It is to a degree, and what you will see with the commissioning intentions item is that where it makes sense to have some commissioning conversations at a greater than borough scale, we do indeed go and do that. I think that we, even if the areas of priority are the same, I think for many of the areas identified in the local health and care plan, my reflection working across two boroughs would be that they can be the same priority areas, but the context in which they need to be developed can be very different between the two boroughs. So, the relationships with different parts of local government, with the voluntary sector, with the acute sector, and the wider healthcare sector can feel very different from the south of Merton to the north of Wandsworth. Yes, and via our collaborative commissioning pension processes, we do identify areas where we can have a conversation, particularly on the more health commissioning side once, but I think even if we are looking at the same areas, I think I would advocate retaining the borough focus in any of those areas, because it is still different from borough to borough.
Yeah, thanks James. I completely agree. And what is helpful is that we acknowledge and learn from each other, but with a real focus and emphasis on implementation, it is the realization how relationship dependent the implementation is, and that has to be locally wired. So I am completely with you. What we're doing about, for example, with directors of public health, we share a lot what we do, and we do share and learn how we do it, but it is fascinating to look at the how is very different. The what is the same, the how is very different.
Quickly, I recall the first thing that I wanted to say that had emerged from the design day, and that was almost without exception, everyone who was commenting on children and young people's thinking alluded to the relationship with schools. as a healthcare provider, it was really clear that he was talking about children and young people. Schools and education needs to be embraced in that conversation, so I wouldn't want that to be lost.
And the next time we see this, will that then be the draft round?
It will be.
We may then want to feed that in through the board to maybe adapt some of this money, because I think we've said about board and it needs to be adaptable. We need to check in, make sure it's still the right parties. Now that we've done that engagement piece, we've got our own piece in action, schools are really important here, but I don't see any reason as a board why we can't draw that attention to partners and maybe work it in when it comes to that. So we can probably come back with more up to date version of the on that engagement.
Thank you. Right, item 13, again on the supplementary agenda, CCG commission intentions.
Okay, so just to explain to those who are unfamiliar with what the purpose of commission intentions are, commission intentions is a process that CCGs go through every year to basically set out areas where we're looking to transform services. Or to make some changes, other changes to services within the borough. And the process we broadly go to is that we are continually developing our analysis of areas where we may need to improve the quality or the efficiency of the outcome of services. This is done having worked with public health colleagues in terms of responding to the general scenario, but also to other analyses that we get through our own service provision. And in about September of the year, we start to put those down in terms of a set of a portfolio of initiatives for the following year. Necessarily, there's always some continuity in the issues facing the borough and services in the borough don't change dramatically from year to year, so there's always some continuity. It's a slightly different context for commissioning intentions this year from Merton and the East South of London CCDs is the fact that we are all developing our local health and care plans, and particularly in Merton, we do have the Merton Health and Care Together programme. So you will see very significant read-across between many of the initiatives set out in the Start Well, Live Well and Age Well pages of this presentation and the schemes within Merton Health and Care Together. And broadly, the CCG's position is that we should not be pursuing substantial transformation at a borough level that falls outside of MHCT because we are fully committed to working through that programme. However, there are a number of areas where we need to work at greater than borough level. Our acute transformation, so we work collaboratively with Wandsworth CCG, everybody around St George's, but also with Sutton CCG around St Helier and with Kingston and Richmond CCGs around Kingston for our own park and Wandsworth park populations in order to implement necessary changes to both primary care and urgent care. And out of necessity, many changes that we need to consider around mental health services need to be considered on a southwest London wide footprint because a lot of services operate on a larger footprint than just borough or indeed London basis. So there are also some rights within the documents as well. This is a summary of a point in time of where we're up to, and I have to say, even since submission of this paper, there's a number of areas that have moved on slightly. We're in the process of engagement around this, including with providers and stakeholders, and during quarter four, we will turn all these schemes, either or in the process of doing it, into contracting intentions, which then go into our contracts with providers. And that's everyone from St George's and St Helier at the top end of the scale, right the way down to smaller voluntary sector organisations within the contract. So it's that process is quarter four. I don't propose to go through the detail. I'm happy to take any.
Those things flag up in the context of the health and care plan, which is no commission intentions currently around that level of confidence into adulthood. And one of the things that I would anticipate is that we would look to find a way to commission providers so that if someone had started in their service before the age of 18, they were able to provide continuity beyond the legal age of adulthood. So that's not requiring services to to open the doors to 19 to 25 year olds who haven't previously accessed the service, but allowing some kind of hand-holding for a period of time before people have access to the services or require to access the services, so that there isn't that sharp at some point. So I'm hoping that will be open to consideration.
I think absolutely, and I think hope through making it a priority for that health care together, we might identify some of the key areas we know from some engagement insight work we've done the way that it is a particular, for example, for people with developmental conditions, where there is quite a difference between the services available to children and the services available to adults. So I don't anticipate that would be one of the areas we need to look at. But I think what I would probably say so firmly for now is let's pick it up for MHCT, and we're absolutely looking to reflect it. Right, so back on the main agenda now, item number 10 on the main agenda, which is the health protection program.
Yeah, so that's me very briefly. I'm sorry, it got a bit split, so I draw your attention to the colour paper, which is actually in the supplementary, because I don't want to drown you with the actual protection protocol. Just very few words by way of context. Local authorities, since the Health and Care Act, have a duty of oversight for health protection function that covers mainly immunisation, screening, emergency preparedness and infection control. It is very important to understand that the reforms in 2013 have fragmented the health protection system considerably, and the local authority has oversight but does not commission or provide any of these services. So it's a slightly odd function. The purpose of the protocol is to help us to deliver our duty in a robust and meaningful way. And it's really a document that is clear about roles and responsibilities and gathers together protocols and pathways. And I would like you to note it and to promote it within your organizations. And if there's any feedback, please send it back to us.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Not a question about the protocol, but at council last week, there were a number of questions around child immunization and immersion, obviously, we're quite low. And I understand the point about the fragmentation. So what can we do to try and
So we are having a sort of a two-pronged approach. What is really important is that we haven't got the resource, so we cannot now roll up our sleeves and say, let's go out and immunize. That is not our role, nor have we got the resource. The way the oversight function is meant to work is that we work as a system, and we have got very good relationship with NHS England and Public Health England, who are the main commissioners, and annually we invite them to the Overview and Scrutiny Committee, and they will give a sort of a report of the performance and their action plans, and we scrutinise them. And what we try to do within reason is to use as much local assets that we have to support them. So although we haven't got the resource for social marketing, when campaigns come down for Public Health England, we use our comms and we work with the CCG comms so that we use our dissemination contacts to spread. We feed back, we have got, as I said, very good relationships with them. So if we have understanding of why uptake is low, for example, they haven't necessarily got the granularity, we feed it back. So, for example, on some of the low uptake on cervical screening, we have escalated that up to London level, and so they are doing an in-depth study to see how that can be improved. So it's not always direct, but we're trying to be creative to see what we can do within the allocated roles and responsibilities.
Questions or comments?
last year we did some business contingency planning, and I kind of wish this had been here then because I could have read it. I mean, would you say that partners should be sort of reading this and incorporating it into their own policies? Because it's, you know, you sort of said take it back to your organisations, but I suppose I'm just struggling to get a sense of how it might be used.
So what I meant, pick out what is relevant for your organisation. That's the proposal. And it is a lot of very specialist advice and contacts that are totally irrelevant. But I was particularly thinking about our health colleagues, because some of our providers are those that actually do the screening or do the immunisation. And that's, we have worked very closely with them. You can see it at the list of participants. It applies more to our NHS partners on this occasion than to the volunteers.
I was thinking more about the emergency.
Poppy pop would be really hot is kind of the winter panic stop. Because actually that's moving away from immunisation for a moment. And isn't it the cold weather kicks in, that's what affects all of our service users across the place. So I think making that into your contingency plan extend into our overall approach to kind of the winter panic and the two disappears is really helpful.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dates for the Future Health and Wellbeing Boards, we will circulate them. If anyone wants to take a note, we've got two agreed already, so that's the 29th of January and the 26th of March. These are all Tuesdays. And then the proposed dates for next year are the 25th of June, the 8th of October, 26th of November, 28th of January, now for instance 20. And the 24th of March, but they will all be circulated and they still need to be agreed by the council. Finally, we're trying to ensure that every member of the board has gone through their dementia friendly training as part of our ambition to be dementia friendly by 2020. So I've been asked to ask for a show of hands if anyone hasn't had their training. Keep them up long enough for Clarissa to name them down.
Thank you very much.
So some training, I think we'll try and organise something for those who haven't been trained.
Is there an opportunity to do that with either the wider voluntary sector or our
yes.
own organisation? Because I mean, I could do it, but
yeah, happy to widen it. So I think Clarissa will be in touch directly and we'll try and organise something. Okay, thank you very much.